Happy Thursday, everyone. It is such a joy to be in the presence of God's people, knowing of a truth that He is here in our midst. Welcome to the continuation of our Week of Prayer 2021. This year, we're looking at the theme, I Will Go, Sent to Share. And specifically this morning, we're looking at a loving warning from God, the third angel's message. This message is one of hope to God's people, and it is also one of hope to those with whom we share. May God help us this morning that as we share together, that we will indeed be richly blessed as much as we are divinely favored.
Let us pray. Our eternal God and our Father, we indeed thankful, Lord, for this morning, for waking us this morning. Thank you, Lord, for your many blessings and mercy and grace. We thank you, Father, that we can, in spite of this pandemic, and very much because of this pandemic, we can meet like this. We thank you for this medium in which we can meet and continue our prayer, week of prayer like this. Indeed, it's a means by which we can reach even further and reach other persons who might not have been physically able to attend because of their geographic location. So we thank you, Lord. We ask, Heavenly Father, that you forgive our sins, cleanse us from unrighteousness, prepare us, O Lord, prepare our hearts to go into this as we go into this prayer session, the prayer sessions, that you will, all hearts will be prepared to for your word. We pray, Heavenly Father, that even in this time of pandemic, that you will protect one and all, O Father, from either contracting or transmitting this virus now that is wreaking havoc around the world. We ask, Lord, that as we go into this session, that you will, our speaker, O Lord, you have been using him mightily for the past week, and we expect no less this morning. We ask that you will bless him and keep him and give him a word this morning. As our theme this morning, we understand it's the three angels' message, very relevant message, present truth in this time. Give the message, power, Father, and our heart's conviction as we're listening. Continue to bless, guide, and keep us throughout this day, and even throughout the remainder of this session and season. We ask these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen.
At this time, we're going to have our special feature. You know, we have been focusing on the benefit of prayer since we started. And we are going to be looking at another of the benefits. You know that prayer is the means by which we talk to our Heavenly Father. And if we are able to talk to our Heavenly Father, then naturally there will be benefits. Dear friends, today we continue to look at the benefits of prayer. Prayer increases faith. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, that faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You see, for the believer who practices a life of being constant in prayer, faith becomes the deciding factor. Faith becomes an anchor, the driving force. It is faith that says, keep going when all odds are against him. Prayer increases our faith, and faith is present. when this faith is present, we know that there is the absence of fear. And do we remember what God says to us in 2 Timothy 1 verse 7? He says, he has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Through the prayer of faith, God will help us to break down strongholds, lift up the fallen, strengthen the weak, and give courage to the downtrodden. Faith is what says, start cooking when you know there is no food in the pantry. It is what says to you, that job is going to be supplied when you're at your wit's end. It is faith that says, make that application to the university when you know you don't even have the application. Faith says, be anxious for nothing, but in all things, through prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. In Matthew 7:7, we are told that the prayer of faith, it tells us to ask and it shall be given. Seek and we shall find. Knock and the door will be opened. The more we pray, the stronger our faith. And let's not forget that without faith, it is impossible to please God. When we approach God, brethren, we must believe that he is and that he rewards those who seek him diligently. In the prayer of faith, Ellen White tells us in the book Prayer and Faith, page 258, she says, in the prayer of faith, there is divine science. It is the science that everyone who would make his life work a success must understand. You know, people are searching for success in so many different ways. And here we have the source, prayer. Christ says, whatsoever things ye desire, when ye pray, believe that he received them and he shall have them. That's Mark 11, verse 24. He makes it plain that our asking must be in according to God's will. We must ask for the things that he has promised, and whatever we receive must be used doing his will. The conditions met, the promise is supplied. In the book Prayer, page 15, she says, prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. The eye of faith will discern God's nearness, and the suppliant may obtain precious evidence of the divine love and care for him. Friends, heaven is open to our petitions, and we are invited to come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy, that we may find grace in the help, in help of need. We are to come in faith, believing that we shall obtain the very thing we ask of him. Prayer increases our faith. That's one of the benefits. So I say to all of us, pray on.
The army of Judah was paralyzed by fear when they heard a mighty multitude was quickly drawing near. But as they prayed for the victory, for when we call, we surrender. For you are the Lord. Small of us, instead of all of us, And your prayers may seem in vain. They don't seem to make a difference. They don't seem to make a change. Sure, God knows your need, and He hears each prayer you pray. Your prayers are reaching heaven, and the answer's on the way. Hey, you are who you are looking for. It doesn't matter if I'm walked out. Stay alive. When you feel the love of love is wild,
amen, amen. Pray on for your who. The Lord is looking for, stay on your knees, for this is where the battle is won. Very soon you will win the victory. Pray on. And that is the three angels' message to tell people that you can carry your burdens to God, because when you bring them to God, God will work it out for you. And don't bring them to God and bring them anywhere else. When you bring them to God, leave it there, leave it there. Won't you leave your burdens there? Take your burdens to the Lord, leave it there. Thank you, Sister Vashti, for that wonderful song, Pray On. Even though the internet was fighting, even though the internet was raging its battle, we are so glad that you came out victorious, even the last note. Pray on. If they haven't heard, or if anybody didn't hear anything, you can say you hear the last word. Pray on. Wonderful, wonderful song. Good morning, everyone. I hope and pray that you are up and revived, that you are feeling energized, even though the week is passing, near approach its end, and you're saying that there's a lot to be done, that today you are still a side of the living, so you still can find courage to fight on to the end. Fight on to the end, my friend. Even so, I want to thank Sister Forbes Williams for her wonderful words of introduction. I also want to thank her for her reading in the morning. Even yesterday, it was a missing piece, but we're so glad that she is here this morning, and she's doing a wonderful job. And even those who would have come on yesterday, we want to say thanks. And every day, thank you for coming out. I also want to say a big welcome or thanks to my mother and my sister who I'm seeing online, who are supporting me in my ministry. I want to say a big thanks to them. And again, I want to say a big thanks to the church, especially my Elder Bowen. He's a good friend of mine. I can't say it too much, but I'm so glad that the church has afforded me the opportunity. And I will not waste your time this morning. We go back to our scripture reading, but bow your heads with me as we pray to our God before we go into His word. Loving Father, we know you're a God who gives understanding. You're a God who gives instruction. And even so, you would have given us your word so we can understand time. We can understand where we are at in history. We are praying even now for understanding, that the dark places may be made clear, that our understanding may be enlightened. And even as we are, some person are being reminded of that which they know, help it to become even more real today. Help it to become a part of our lives, that we may be able to glorify your name even more. Bless us now, we do ask in your son that we pray and say thanks. Amen, amen, amen. With our scripture passage in hand, we turn back to the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 14. Since Sabbath, we would have looked at the first and second angel's message. We would have talked so lovely about what they are trying to tell us in history, what they are trying to tell us for this time. How are they instructing us? But the Bible have us to understand why the Adventist Church chooses the three angels' message for its theme. Why does the church took this piece of spaghetti and say that even though people are saying the book of Revelation is closed, why does the church take the same words and say we must apply these words not only because they are God's words, but well, mostly because they are God's words, but they are perfect instruction for the time that we are living in. Yes, we would have talked how we can see this message coming from Genesis straight back up to Revelation. We would have drawn from even the book of Daniel, another Old Testament prophetic book, and we would have seen how the same thing is being played out throughout history. But today we are looking at the third angel's message, and it says, "And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or his hand." And there is a comma, but I'll just pause there and I'll deal with this verse, then I'll head over to the next verse. The Bible have us to understand that while the angels would have gone and they would have told people that they need to come out of Babylon, while they are here shouting and a herald to say that time is at hand and that time is wrapping up, while time is going to its close, the Bible bring our attention to something that we must take note of. The Bible says, it says with a loud voice, the three angels have been proclaiming and they are saying, we cannot say this message softly. We cannot preach without any vigor. We cannot preach as if we are fenke fenke. We cannot go out and whisper this to anybody. We have to shout it at the top of our voice. We have to shout it on the top of the hill. We have to shout it on the top of the church. We have to shout it anywhere we are that somebody may hear, and before it is too late, turn from their wicked way. They have to hear, and not only hear, but they have it as a witness, not only to save them, but against them. Can I tell you that the message of God will stand not only a witness to save some? God, it is a sad reality, but the truth is the singing message of God will stand to be a witness against many, many people who are even in church today. The same gospel will stand as a witness to say, you would have heard, you would have seen sign, you would have witnessed my words true, and you would have understand that you need to change. But people are so neglectful that they will not change. Just the same, the Bible is saying, you don't matter who you see. It doesn't matter who hears, but everybody must hear. You cannot skip anybody. Hence, you got to shout it out loud. You got to shout it out clear. So even if a person is just passing by and they hear about the goodness of God, they hear that judgment is already set and the book is soon will be open, they got to ask themselves, how will I stand in that great day when every thought, every word, every action, God, the righteous judge, shall weigh? Somebody ought to hear that before it is eternally too late, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything will be added unto you. But here is what the Bible wants us to understand. You see, when you look at the great controversy, when you look at what is happening around you, there is only one thing you can recognize, is that there is a fight for worship. What do you mean, preacher? It means that the devil is fighting to say, I need the same authority, I need the same amount of recognition that God has gotten, and I want even more. He says, the Bible asks, how art thou fallen, O Lucifer? How art thou cast down? You said in your heart that you will ascend into the holy place. You will be like the Most High himself. But can I tell you, I tell you before, I have learned that there is one thing that no created being can manage. That is called worship. Anytime mankind is given power or authority, we often mess up ourselves. The Bible says Lucifer was an anointed cherub. He was
was dear. He was before God. He was perfect. He was righteous. He was dear even in the presence of God. He would minister. His musical instrument is in him. He can sing well. He can speak well. He can do everything well. But in his heart is far from God. Worship is the same thing we are having problem with today. Mankind has corrupted God's ideal, God's way of worship, telling mankind that they can live any and anyhow, that they can't. Well, Solomon said, you can do whatsoever you please, but remember at the end of it that there is a judgment that is already set. It's just a matter of time. The Bible says, if any man worship the beast or his image. Ah, no, you ask me, preacher, what is the beast? I hear in 2021 that there is a big controversy. Because Rastafarian are saying this is a beast. Once upon a time, it was a chip. Now it is corona, a vaccine, and mankind are now confused. I learned a trick from the devil. You see, the devil has a way of getting you confused that you will not recognize reality. What do you mean, preacher? Just like Adam and Eve, here is what the devil do. He tells you things that you think are true and then let you become deceived. What do you mean, preacher? It means just like how he told Adam and Eve that when they eat of the fruit, they will be like God himself. But Adam and Eve never recognized that within them they had an authority. They had some level of authority that made them as many gods on earth. But they gave up their position because they wanted too much out of life. They had it already. Their eyes were already perfect, but they wanted more. I find out that those people in life who are unable to satisfy will find themselves in trouble soon because we are not satisfied with the position. We want to be like God himself. We want to dictate how things are supposed to happen. What do you mean, preacher? I'm talking about those people who are trying to tell God when to act, where to act, and how to act. We are telling God that God is wicked because God would have passed judgment on people who deserve it. I hear for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. None of us deserve anything but death. None of us deserve any good, but it only the goodness and the mercies of God, while you and I aren't consumed as yet. Every time we think about what we would have done, the truth is, if you're an honest Christian, if you are a Christian who is living by the word of God, when you look at yourself, you will understand that your righteousness is as filthy rags. But I hear that mankind want to put themselves perfect in front of a perfect God, but sin and sinners cannot dwell in his place. The Bible says that if any man worship the beast or its image. What do you mean, preacher? Mankind has become confused and looking to man for salvation. Mankind has become confused and looking to people to save them. Instead of turning to Jesus, we are turning to man. There is only one power given on the earth, or one name given on the earth by which we might be saved, under the heavens by which we might be saved. And that is wrapped up in Jesus, I tell you, time after time. But mankind is following a system. A system that tells you that mankind is able to free you from sin. What system you call that? We call it the papal power. That is where one of the biggest confusion comes. We start to find ourselves, mankind want to wield the hand of God, want to tell God how to act. They say, what we bind, it is bind in heaven. We can even find you in your death grave when you are already dead. While Solomon would have tell us that there is no repentance in the grave. He said in Ecclesiastes, better to be a living dog than a dead lion, because there is no repentance in the grave. You cannot call out to God. I tell you, there is nobody can set your soul right except you and God himself. If you don't turn over your soul for yourself, even though you're praying for your loved one, you have to pray that their eyes may be open, because the truth is your prayer is good, but they need to seek God for themselves. You cannot save anybody. You only pray that they may turn over their life to Jesus before it is too eternally too late. But a system tells you that this is possible. I can even reach in the grave and bind these people to heaven. Why? If you give me some money, I find that in 2021 and throughout ages, riches have caused men to be more confused than anything. What do you mean, preacher? Don't get me wrong. I'm not telling you that it's wrong to have money. I'm not telling you that once you have money, you are going to hell. But anytime you find that we are thinking too much about living in a luxurious life, a life that is free of wants and free of needs, I find out anytime we don't have wants, we forget God. Check Israel. Anytime Israel was at a point where they need not pray for anything, they neglect God. And just the same today, many of us are seeking to be at a point where we don't have to ask God for anything. We want to be at a place where we don't have to worship God, because it seems as if we are doing it on our own. We are the one who provided bread. We are the one who provided water. But I learned that anytime, yesterday I tell you, when the chicken is too merry, the hawk is near. When chicken heart get too merry, hawk is near. But here is what the Bible says, that if any man worship this beast, can I tell you something? We keep on talking about Babylon. Babylon is one of the theme of this three angels message. Babylon is a system that the system want to show you. The book want to get you to understand. But here is what you must realize, that if you're not a part of God's system, then you are a part of the beast system. What does that mean? If you are not walking and talking and living with God, then you are walking, talking, and living with a beast. What does that mean? That means, therefore, if your life is not turned over to God, there is no middle ground. There is no hopscotch business. You're either right or you're wrong. There is no gray area. There is no middle ground for you to stand. Either you're standing on the solid rock, the solid foundation, or you are on slippery ground. You're on wet sand or sinking sand. You are on a place where you will go down. It is either right or wrong. But here is what the Bible says. Now you have to take real attention to how you receive this mark. Either you receive it in your foreheads or in your hand. What does that mean? It's either you make the decision, or you are making the decision in your mind to go against the thus say the Lord, or you are doing things that are against the thus say the Lord. What does that mean, preacher? Either by your works or your thoughts, you are condemning your life. Either by your works or your thoughts, you are stepping out of God's reach. Either by your works or your thoughts, you are saying that to away with God and give me Baal. By your works, I hear that some men are saying that the only a clean hand and a pure heart shall see God. Yes, the Bible says, and I ask you, how clean is your heart? Is your heart at a perfect place? And let me remind you that when scriptures talk about the heart, it links not only the heart to God, but it also link your mind. Sometimes when I think of all the evils that run through my mind, when I hear about some people doing certain things, and the thought come to me, them the people be dead. Even sometimes as Christians, when we think about the evil that is in the world, instead of crying out for God to save people, we think about that these people belong in the grave, or they should have died, or they need to die. But sometimes God is saying that you have to think on heavenly things. You have to consecrate your mind. You got to pray for a mind like God. You have to pray for a heart like him that sees good, or seek to save the lost, that is crying out to people, that you need to put your life in God. Now in your hands, talk about your work. In your hands, talk about your work. Are your works pure? Are your works clean? Are your works at a place where God can say, there goes a child of the king. There goes a child of mine. Because if your works are not clean, if your works are not pure, if your works are evil, then you are a part of the beast system. What does that mean, preacher? By your fruit, you shall know them. You can't be a Christian and you are not working for God. I tell you, if you're not working for God, then you are working against against him. What does that mean, preacher dear? It's coming a time when, because of what man thinks, because they want to have their make a decision, they're not making a decision for God. They will make a decision for the devil in their mind. There is coming a time. In this time, if you are not working for God, then you are working to enhance the devil's kingdom. I'm gonna say it again. The truth is, if you have not made up your mind to walk and talk and live and think about heavenly things, if you're not making up your mind to see Jesus even when he comes, then you are automatically making up your mind to stay with the devil. If you are not making your works pure and true before God, then your works are of the devil. But here is what the Bible says, that if you don't make this decision before it's too late, if you don't do what you need to do now, here is what the Bible says, that the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God. Now, wait a second. This is not the first time I'm hearing about wine in this scripture. This is not the first time I'm hearing about wine in this word. I know my time is running. But here is what the Bible says in verse 8, that if you, Babylon has caused many to drink the wine of her fornication. But here is what the Bible says, that even though the devil's wine would have appeased to many, even though the devil's wine would have caused many to step out of bounds, even though the devil's wine may be sweet, there is something that is really bitter that is coming at the end. We say God is a loving and a merciful God, but the truth is, you must be reminded that God is also a just God, that God is a God who reward not only the faithful but also the wicked. Here is what the Bible says, the same shall drink of the wrath of God. And then ask, what is the wrath of God? What is his wine? How does it taste? The Bible says it is poured out without mixture. That means that there is no diluting of this wrath. There is no safe ground if you're on the devil's side when this wrath is poured out. There is no thing that you can find that can quench the wrath of God. In olden times, he tried to use water in the antediluvian world. When he tried to use water, mankind became sinners again because there was mercy mixed with the judgment. There was mercy even there, but even then he tried again, and we learn of Sodom and Gomorrah, and we hear that when he poured out wrath, even while he would have saved, and even while we are living with the testimony of these people, mankind still turned back to sin. But here is what he says, in the last days, at that time when Michael will stand, at that time when judgment has set and the books would have been opened, when he poured out his wine, or when he is pouring out his wine, he says, this time I will put mercy aside. And he will say, he that is just, let him remain just still. And he that is filthy, let him remain filthy. For this time there is no mercy. There is no repentance. There is no chance for a second deliverance. There is no more word. There is no more interceding. There is no more high priest. There is no more mercy. But there will be judgment. And he says, when this judgment is poured out, that there are many that will be tormented because of brimstone. I hear that on that day, he says, I'm going to pour out fire because I've tried water and water have failed. But this time when I try and I see that you guys are determined to find hell or to make hell your home, I'm gonna let it stay. I'm closing. I know my time is up. But here is what the Bible says. Even while we think of these things, that mercy is still lingering. The truth is, it has not yet started. Hence, mercy is still lingering. Today, you can find mercy at the feet of Jesus. The image of the beast, I tell you on Sabbath, you need not fear once you have the mark of God. I wish I was at church, but do not fear the image of the beast because you have the mark of God. You just have to set yourself where you can be marked as one who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. They that overcome only overcome
because they were washed in the blood of the Lamb. This morning, pray that you may be washed thoroughly, that you may not fear, because God has never given us a spirit of fear, but of a sound of love, and of a sound mind. Fret not thyself of evildoers, because end is near, but worry of where your soul lies. Pray to God that he may put you in a place where you can be free, because who the Lord set free is free indeed. Let us pray. Loving Father, we're so glad for your written words, because in them we can find courage, we can find the strength, that even though the devil is fighting, his end is already marked out. But we have to now make a decision whether we are for the devil or we are for you. Today we pray, Father, that none who is in the hearing of my voice will choose to walk with the devil, but they will condemn the ways of the devil, condemn the ways of the beast, and live for you even now, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. What a word. He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. Thank you, Pastor. We now move into a very special session where all of us will be involved. We're going to be united in prayer, and these are the foci: the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to awaken us to Christ's likeness, the mission to be each member's focus, the containment of COVID-19, God's leading in the upcoming Jamaica Union Conference session, and by extension, we pray for our local conference, West Jamaica. We're going to pray also for our local congregation. Please remember to mention the leadership, the young people. And finally, we will look at our backsliders and unconverted spouses of our brethren, because our mission is to start at home, to get our people back, and then we move beyond the bounds. Sister Francis, I now turn over to you to assign the rooms. What a joy it has been this morning, being in the company of God's people, and of course, being in the presence of a holy God. We have come, we have been refreshed. We really have tasted, and I believe that we can say that we have been filled up, charged for yet a little longer in the journey. Allow me therefore to say thanks to all the participants this morning. I thank all the prayer ministers, elders and other members who led out and all who prayed. Special thanks to Pastor Billings for allowing the Holy Spirit to use him in such a marked way to remind us of the word that cheered our heart and was wanting to cheer us. Sister Garvey, thank you so much for that lovely song, Pray On, and we assure you by God's grace that we will continue to pray. Sister Tasha Gay, thank you for reading the word of God so ably, and of course, Brother Allen, who led us to the throne of grace. Above that, brethren, thank you all for joining in. It was a joy seeing Sister Miller Wisdom this morning. Thank you for coming, and just to inform all participants that even after we would have ended our week of prayer, we continue in the morning, same time, 6 to 7, for praise and prayer. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming in. Just before we go, we now have a special song from Sister Nicole Cunningham. Thank you.
number one would surely be me. And I thought I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could build my life, but I can't even walk without a home. I thought I had a lot on my own, and I thought I could make it all alone. I thought I a mighty big woman, I can't even walk without you holding my hand. Lord, the mountain is so high, and the valley so wide. Down on my knees, Lord, where I've learned to say, Lord, I can't even walk without you holding my hands. See, I thank God that I made Jesus. He's my all in all. He's here all this morning. From now on his name, see, I'm surely gonna call. And if I don't trust him, I'll be less than a human, since I can't even walk without him holding my hands. Hold on to our hands, Jesus. We can't even walk without Christ holding your hands. Sometimes a mountain is so high, and the valley is too wide. But down on our knees, we've learned to stay, God. We can't even walk without you holding our hands. Praise God.
Thank you, Sister Nicole. The Lord bless you and keep you all, and cause his face to shine upon you, and may he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. And amen.